Audible Inc. presents Social TV, how marketers can reach and engage audiences by connecting television to the web, social media, and mobile. Written by Mike Proulx and Stacey Shepatin. Narrated by William Dufris. For the late Don Harley, your mentorship has forever lighted my lamp. MCP. For WJRD, keep watching. SSH. Preface. What is in a name? Television has always been social. It would seem then that the name of our book, Social TV, implies that there is nothing new to say about the beloved entertainment medium. Yet that could not be further from the truth. Television nowadays is a very different experience than it was in 1941, when TV advertisements first began airing in the United States. According to its strictest definition, the phrase social TV was coined to depict the convergence of television and social media. However, social TV has often been used in recent years as a catch-all expression when referring to the modern era of television. While we tend to prefer the former definition, we painted using broad brushstrokes throughout the book. Television's love affair with social media comprises a sizable chunk of our narrative. We also tackle the effect that mobile and tablet devices have had on the medium, chapters 4 and 8, and examine the growing impact of internet-connected TVs, chapter 9. Recognizing that the blending of media also gives TV audiences a much more personalized experience, we even included a section dedicated to addressable advertising, chapter 7. We wrote this book as a guide for marketers. Each chapter illustrates a slice of the television landscape, fraught with examples and case studies, followed by a deep dive into the advertising implications that result. We intend social TV to appeal not only to brands, but also agencies, television networks, content creators, educators, and even TV viewers. In order to keep the audiobook manageable in size and scope, we focus primarily on broadcast television series and events. While we have included some content on news and sports, each of those verticals could be a book in and of themselves. Though we interviewed nearly 50 companies and featured many additional ones throughout social TV, it simply was not possible to include a description of or story about every player within the space. New companies with interesting solutions seem to crop up every week. So instead, we attempted to provide enough of a representative cross-section to help illustrate the most important trends that are impacting television today. You will also notice that, because things are changing at breakneck speed, Chapter 11 can only be accessed online. We purposefully waited to write the last chapter just as social TV was released in order to bring you the most up-to-date information. That is why one need not go back over 7 decades to witness the profound shift in the media landscape. Television is changing before our very eyes. It is a perpetual work in progress, a living medium influenced by advances in technology and evolutions in human culture. Yet as TV continues to change in both form and function, it will forever remain social at its core. Welcome to Social TV. Mike and Stacy. Introduction. The World of Tomorrow. On Thursday, April 20, 1939, Radio Corporation of America President David Sarnoff announced the dawn of commercial television in the United States. Sarnoff's remarks described the medium as a new art, so important in its implications that it is bound to affect all society. His address strategically took place 10 days before the opening ceremony of the New York World's Fair. Themed as The World of Tomorrow, the RCA-owned National Broadcasting Company fittingly transmitted U.S. President Franklin D. Roosevelt's keynote address over the airwaves, marking the official birth of regularly scheduled television broadcasts in the United States. With much public allure surrounding this new medium, Popular Mechanics featured an article by Mr. Sarnoff in its September 1939 issue simply titled, The Future of Television. Underscoring the importance of content in the pioneering world of TV, Sarnoff wrote, "Let us consider next what sort of programming material television may present to its audience." Throughout the many decades to come, writers and producers rose to the challenge to create programming that entertained and touched television audiences by providing them with a temporary escape from the often stark realities of the world outside of their living rooms. Many remember watching Lucy and Ethel try to wrap chocolate candies off of a speedy conveyor belt on September 15, 1952, in what is today a classic I Love Lucy moment. 44% of households tuned into the Beverly Hillbillies on January 8, 1964, to see Granny chase a kangaroo around the Clampett's home in the Giant Jackrabbit episode. Audiences were in tears by the dramatic story told in Roots, an eight-part miniseries that made its debut on January 23, 1977. The Cosby Show's young Rudy Huxtable endeared us when she lip-synced Margie Hendrix on October 10, 1984. Yada, yada, yada is forever ingrained in our common lexicon, thanks to the hilarious April 24, 1997 episode of Seinfeld. And millions of viewers watched a star be born on September 4, 2002, as Kelly Clarkson was named the very first American Idol. Television has produced countless resonant moments throughout its history. Even those who have not been moved or affected by a TV series have most certainly been impacted by watching events, news, or sports unfold across their screens. As Sarnoff wrote in 1939, with the advent of television, the combined emotional results of both seeing and hearing an event or a performance at the instant of its occurrence become new forces to be reckoned with. But TV shows, events, news, and sports are not the only content on television. TV advertising can resonate, too. A television commercial is also content that has the potential to evoke resonance. The phrase, "I cry at Hallmark commercials," is a common and familiar one. It is hard to forget the 1979 Coca-Cola ad featuring a disgruntled Mean Joe Green limping his way down a football stadium ramp. After being given a bottle of Coke from a young boy, the Pittsburgh Steelers defensive player gently tosses his football jersey to him, saying, "Hey, kid, catch." We were similarly heartened in 2011 by young Darth Vader trying to exert his telekinetic powers on a series of objects in and around his house. The exercise bike, the family dog, the washer and dryer, a baby doll, and even his sandwich. To his extreme disappointment, the Force did not seem to be strong within him. But then his dad, arriving home from work, pulls up his Volkswagen Passat into the driveway. A reinvigorated Vader seizes the opportunity to give his powers a go just one more time. As he channels all of his concentration and might, while extending and pointing his arms toward the front of the car, the ignition suddenly fires, thanks to Dad using the remote starter. Our adorable Darth Vader is visibly shocked that, from his point of view, the Force came through for him after all. The resonance of this particular Volkswagen TV commercial drove people online to experience it again and to share it with others. The official VW YouTube upload has generated over 45 million views and is a great example of how the web and television are complementing versus competing with one another. The Internet did not kill television. While many people have proclaimed the death of television, the over 70-year-old medium is as healthy and alive as it has ever been. In fact, we are watching more television than ever before. According to research company Nielsen, the average American watches just over 35 hours of television per week, in spite of the rise in online and mobile video viewing. The Internet has not killed TV. It has actually become its best friend. It is a companion for the growing masses of television viewers who are simultaneously going online while tuning in to their favorite shows. The web, social media, and mobile are rapidly converging with television and affecting the way in which we experience programming. David Sarnoff wrote a prophetic statement in 1939, "Television will finally bring to people in their homes, for the first time in history, a complete means of instantaneous participation in the sights and sounds of the entire outer world." Over seven decades later, we are facing a period of déjà vu. Social media has created a new and powerful backchannel that is fueling the renaissance of live broadcasts. Mobile and tablet devices, allow us to watch and experience both on-demand and live television whenever and wherever we want. And connected TVs blend web and television content into a unified big-screen experience, once again, at the center of our living rooms. Although the television industry is undergoing a grandiose state of flux, it is also in the midst of one of its most exciting time periods, the outcome of which will only make TV more compelling, more interactive, and more accessible. And while the way in which we experience television continues to evolve, the medium is here to stay. The rise of a new medium does not always mean the end of another. What does this mean for television advertising? Just as television is changing, so is its advertising. The blending of media channels has created new opportunities for marketers to reach and engage with their target audiences. And this shifting television landscape is not just affecting advertising creative, but also how agencies plan and buy media. Brands can no longer simply consider the program that is being broadcast on the television set. To do so is myopic and, frankly, short-sighted. They must instead look at the larger cross-channel media experience that occurs nowadays with TV audiences in order to maximize their brand's impact with an ever-increasing distracted world. The core of social TV starts with the back channel, which is why we begin the book here. This is comprised of the millions of public conversations happening online while television programming airs. Brands who find ways to align themselves with or be a part of the back channel unlock an entire audience with whom to engage. Following Chapter 1, the next chapters are sequenced in the order in which audiences tend to experience television. Chapter 2 tackles the quickly evolving social TV guide landscape and examines how individuals discover what to watch in the modern era of television. Once one knows what he or she is going to watch, they may use any myriad of TV check-in apps that are growing in numbers and features, as illustrated in Chapter 3. Chapter 4 builds from our back channel chapter and dives more deeply into the second screen experiences that television viewers have while watching TV. We discuss the concept of synchronized applications here, which provide opportunities for synced advertising. Starting with Chapter 5, we examine what happens after a TV episode concludes to investigate the correlation between social media engagement and television ratings. We look not just at the TV shows themselves, but also how to measure social ratings for TV commercials. Chapter 6 addresses the engagement with television shows that happens in between their episode airings, something we call bridge content. When executed well, this can be a welcomed and ripe territory for branded entertainment. Chapter 7 begins to take a turn in the television landscape with addressable advertising. The ability to target television commercials to eliminate any wasted impressions is the holy grail for brands. Chapter 8 gets us outside of the living room and illustrates the portability and accessibility of television that exists, thanks in large part to mobile and tablet devices. Chapter 9 tackles the notion of web plus television convergence head-on to bring to light the opportunities for brands within the connected TV world. Our book concludes with a case study that ties all of the previous chapters together. We also illustrate how the blending of media is only going to continue making it that much more complex for brands to navigate. Given this, we highlight specific advice to advertisers from several of the industry leaders we interviewed to round out the chapter and the book. Cutting to the chase. The punchline of the book is a simple one, and it all points back to content. As it relates to television, people want to talk about and share the programming, including advertising, that resonates the most with them. Social media cannot and will not save a bad show or make poor products and services look good, but social media absolutely has a powerful amplification effect in the presence of resonant content. And the evidence of this exists right before our very eyes in the millions of social impressions that comprise television's back channel. Chapter 1. The Back Channel, Bringing the Social Conversation to the Forefront. On Sunday, February 9, 1964, the Beatles appeared for the first time on television sets across America. 73 million people tuned in to The Ed Sullivan Show at 8 o'clock Eastern Time to experience the fresh sounds of the hugely anticipated British rock band broadcasting live from New York City on the CBS television network. As the iconic curtain rose for the 779th time, Ed Sullivan welcomed his viewers with news that the Beatles had just received a wire from Elvis Presley wishing them tremendous success in our country. The 728 audience members watching the events unfold in person from CBS TV Studio 50 erupted with loud applause and cheers. Ed Sullivan took his spot on stage following a commercial break and exclaimed five simple words that would trigger a release of the pent-up excitement of over 23,000 U.S. households. "Ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles!" Hysterical screams ensued and held for 8 seconds before "All My Loving," sung by Paul McCartney, kicked off the first of two sets. It was during the second song, "Till There Was You," when each of the Fab Four was introduced via an on-screen lower third overlay of their first name, displayed in bold white block letters. Paul was the first to be introduced, and was quickly followed by Ringo, and then George. As the camera panned over to John Lennon, his name came with a subtitle that read, "Sorry, girls, he's married." This episode, which aired during the Ed Sullivan Show's 17th season, ranks among the most watched primetime broadcasts in U.S. television history. As Sullivan proclaimed, "Tonight, the whole country is waiting to hear England's Beatles." While most of America indeed tuned in, the TV viewing experience was relegated to the living room in 1964. Co-viewing was therefore defined in terms of whatever family members or friends happened to be watching and sitting right next to each other. Hundreds of thousands of simultaneous discussions occurred during that infamous Sunday night. Viewers reacted to the events on their TV screens as they unfolded in real time over the course of the 60-minute show. Yet those conversations were contained within the households in which they took place, and in the hallways and around many water coolers at offices throughout the country on Monday morning. What were the raw, in-the-moment reactions to unexpected turns like the witty John Lennon lower third or message from Elvis? We will never really know for sure beyond viewers' first-hand accounts and reminisced anecdotes. Television and social media have blended. Of course, 1964 was over 4 decades ago. 4 decades before TV viewing audiences started tweeting on Twitter and posting status updates to Facebook. Fast forward 47 years to today's modern television experience, and you'll find that social media has given birth to a real-time backchannel made up of the millions of living, organic social expressions that act as a participatory companion to our favorite TV broadcasts. It exposes the conversations taking place in our once-isolated living rooms and connects households around the world into a single opt-in co-viewing event. Social media has become one of the highest cousage mediums with TV. The portability of today's laptops, coupled with the steady rise in smartphone and tablet adoption, has made cozying up on the couch and being connected to the internet in front of the television not only in vogue, but also a very natural and comfortable part of the TV experience. Forrester Research reports that a survey of close to 3,000 U.S. online adults revealed that 48% claim to use a personal computer while watching TV to chat, browse, or research what they are watching. As the number of people engaging within social media continues to increase, the amount of online conversations about television while shows are airing within those platforms also increases. Meet the Backchannel. The next time you tune into television during its original airtime versus watching something you have recorded on your DVR, type the name of whatever TV show you are watching into Twitter's search box at http://search.twitter.com. You will see, staring right back at you, the raw, real-time, and unfiltered stream of consciousness of the most basic version of television's backchannel. Twitter has become an integral outlet for TV viewers who are looking to express themselves while watching broadcasts of their favorite television programs. Online conversation happens about a given TV show before, during, and after one of its episodes airs. Television's backchannel, however, is defined as the real-time chat that is happening within social media channels during the time that episode is broadcast. Consider it the additive subtext that connects you into a giant virtual co-viewing party. For example, when the Britney Spears episode of hit television program Glee aired on Fox in September of 2010, the backchannel produced over 285,000 tweets about the show. That was back when Twitter averaged about 90 million tweets per day and was just shy of 5% of registered American users. As of July 2011, the Twitter community is producing over 200 million tweets per day. And in September of 2011, Twitter announced it reached 100 million active users. The 2011 Women's World Cup final broke a 7-month-old tweets per second record. 7,196 tweets were created on the backchannel in just 1 second at the end of the soccer game, which was a live television broadcast. This record was trumped 42 days later by Beyoncé's now infamous baby bump reveal at the 2011 MTV Video Music Awards. After her performance of Love on Top, Beyoncé soaked in the audience's applause, tossed her microphone onto the stage, unbuttoned her purple sequined blazer, and showed the world she was pregnant. 8,868 tweets burst into the Twitter backchannel over the course of a single second and spread like wildfire as people across the globe shared the news. In effect, the Twitter backchannel is like an electrocardiogram, EKG, of television's heartbeat. The backchannel is more than Twitter. The average person has liked at least 6 television shows on Facebook. With over 800 million active monthly users worldwide, 30% of whom are in the United States, Facebook is as much a part of the real-time conversation around television as Twitter is. The big difference, however, is that the large majority of Facebook profiles are set as private and therefore bound by the interconnections of Facebook friends only. Yet there are a growing number of ways for communities of interest to publicly connect into the backchannel using this social network. A defining moment for Facebook within the TV space happened when 2 engineers mashed up a newsfeed stream with a video viewer. This laid the groundwork for Facebook's live stream box application piloted during the 2009 presidential inauguration on CNN.com. The result was close to 27 million unique live streams served. Those watching the video stream were able to post Facebook status updates directly from the streaming player and toggle between updates from everyone posting or those just from friends. Among the Facebook and TV network partnerships that ensued includes a special edition of Meet the Press, which aired on January 8, 2012, just 2 days before the New Hampshire primary election. As host, David Gregory moderated the debate amongst Republican presidential candidates. The show was simulcast on the Meet the Press Facebook page. Viewers on Facebook were able to interact and share their questions while following the backchannel conversation as the debate was happening. Twitter gets more attention. To do some of the most interesting, innovative stuff in television today, you actually don't need any new devices. You don't need any new apps or crazy fiber optic infrastructure. What you need is the will to produce TV in a new way. Robin Sloan, Content and Programming at Twitter, Inc. Twitter's simplicity and easy access to its data tends to garner it more attention than any other platform within the social TV space. Its completely open and public nature makes any barriers to participation essentially non-existent. One does not even need to have a Twitter account to view a given tweet stream. As former Twitter's Robin Sloan pointed out to us, one of the things that's very important to any kind of interactive TV technology or platform is that people know the vocabulary and what they're supposed to do. If you have to give people the instruction manual before every experience, it's not going to work. With Twitter, you can put a hashtag on screen or an @handle and people know what you're talking about. They know what that is. I think it's that simple recognition that makes it so incredible. According to a TV Guide research study, 50% of Twitter users discuss the shows they are watching on television versus 35% of Facebook users. When doing the math, it should be noted that the active worldwide Facebook community outnumbers the equivalent Twitter user base by about 8 times. While the behavioral propensity to share TV experiences might be greater on Twitter, the sheer number of people who share ends up being larger on Facebook. However, the study neither addressed the volume of television content shared comparatively between the two social networks, nor weighed their relative amplification effect. Yet the point remains the same. The masses have taken to social networks to share their TV experiences as their favorite shows air, ingraining a new and common behavior in TV viewers everywhere. The Backchannel is reviving live TV. The fact that you can interact on a different level with someone on Facebook or Twitter, or get feedback from stars and experience information coming back to you on the second screen, is driving a lot more people to return to watching television shows as they air. Christina Warren, entertainment editor at Mashable. There is no doubt that social media amplifies the feeling of being connected and part of something bigger when watching television. In an interview with Wall Street Journal's Kara Swisher, Modern Family creator Steve Levitin mentioned how he and his writers monitor the Twitter backchannel during new episode airings of his show. They are able to get a sense of which lines they wrote resonated the most by reading the real-time Twitter laughter that appears in 140-character tweets at a time. While the experience of a highly engaged, lean-forward community is a compelling carrot to entice television viewers to return to the behavior of tuning into television as it airs, the real motivating stick might be the fear of content spoilers. 20% of TVGuide.com users reported that they are watching more live television broadcasts because they do not want the potential of people within their social networks to ruin the plots of their favorite shows. Viewers on the West Coast, who fell victim to the time zone tape delay of the 2011 Grammy Awards, took to social media en masse to blame that same medium for spoiling the broadcast. Winners inevitably ended up trending on Twitter as East Coast friends and followers posted updates 3 hours before a good portion of America was able to tune in. This poses a dilemma for television networks in the age of social media and the real-time web. Content can no longer be contained within time zones. The backchannel has shattered geographical boundaries in a very open, public, and mass-reach way. A single tweet containing a spoiler could amplify and spread to hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people in a matter of hours, if not minutes. In April 2011, the BBC broke new ground when they decided to air the latest season of Doctor Who in the United States on the same day that it premiered in Great Britain. In the past, the delay window between countries was a minimum of a couple of months, causing anxious Americans to seek out and watch copies of the show that were illegally uploaded online. So while social media was spoiling the content, the web at large was actually distributing it. Television networks have embraced the backchannel. It's so easy to forget that 5 years ago, TV producers used to be scared about mentioning a URL on air that somehow it would be a distraction to the audience. Now there is a real feeling that social and digital is making what we're doing on television all the stronger. Ryan Osborne, Director of Social Media at NBC News. For the first time in 30 years, the 2010 Emmy Awards television broadcast had no West Coast time delay. Not only did host Jimmy Fallon integrate viewer tweets into the live broadcast, but NBC parallel broadcasted backstage video online using streaming service Ustream, which has a native Twitter and Facebook social stream backchannel integration. The embedded streaming player across various NBC online properties helped to amplify the backchannel conversation and increase their overall reach. One of the first television networks to bring buzzworthy innovation to the backchannel was MTV, dating back to the 2009 Video Music Awards. In partnership with social media monitoring company Radian 6 and Stamen Design, MTV created a real-time Twitter tracker that visually depicted the volume of tweets about each celebrity by the size of their respective headshot. As the VMA's TV broadcast progressed, the array of celebrity headshots each separately expanded and contracted as the conversation about them increased and decreased. The climax of the visualization experience was when country music star Taylor Swift was awarded Best Female Video, and Kanye West hijacked her acceptance speech. Back on the visual Twitter tracker, the headshots of both Taylor and Kanye dominated the second screen as the back channel exploded with tweets about the incident. A visual ping-pong match ensued for a brief moment as their respective headshots took turns jockeying for screen real estate, until Kanye's headshot practically enveloped the entire screen. There was a staggering amount of Twitter activity about the incident taking place on the real-time Backchannel. In fact, there were close to 2 million tweets over the course of the two coastal VMAs broadcasts, which, at the time, ended up tripling Twitter's average tweet volume. The day after the broadcast, MTV.com had its second-highest record number of visitors ever. The Backchannel gets armed with filters and visuals. The success of MTV's pilot Backchannel visualization during the 2009 Video Music Awards led them to enhance and expand the concept for the 2010 Movie Awards broadcast, which produced even greater engagement results. The network has since brought the Backchannel to life visually for all of its televised award shows. Toward the end of 2010, Bravo launched its version of a Twitter tracker, aptly called the @BravoTV Tweet Tracker. Users are able to easily segment the Twitter conversation by TV show and then drill down and engage with individual tweets about that show. The entire experience is embedded into Bravo's website and wrapped within a compelling and even somewhat addicting user experience. The elegance of Bravo's solution is that it is always on, which provides round-the-clock back-channel engagement for the network's die-hard fans. TV shows realize the power of the hashtag. It is becoming commonplace and best practice for TV shows to display on-screen Twitter hashtags. This serves as both an acknowledgement that there is already a back-channel conversation taking place on Twitter, as well as an instructional prompt for viewers to join in by tweeting their own thoughts. It creates a back-channel amplification effect with a very simple execution. Comedy Central displayed a persistent Comedy Awards hashtag in the lower left corner of the TV screen throughout the duration of its 2-hour Comedy Awards show. Many of the Fox Network shows are now sporting individual hashtags, including #Glee. And viewers tuning in to the summer 2011 HBO season premieres were met with show name hashtags appearing on new episode previews that effectively prompted them to tweet about the given program on the Backchannel. Twitter has found through their own analysis, after having conducted numerous television integrations, that there is an immediate 2 to 10 times increase in the number of Backchannel tweets created about a given TV show when an on-screen hashtag is included in the broadcast. Our tweets are becoming television content. Two pioneering TV shows that integrated Backchannel Twitter content directly into their actual television broadcasts are Late Night with Jimmy Fallon and 106 and Park. One of the shows selects content in between episode airings, while the other does it live from the real-time Backchannel. Both employ the use of various hashtags to elicit near-instant responses from TV viewers and Twitter followers. Late Night has found its groove with social media by reaching out to fans in a way that generates hilarious content for the show, using actual tweet responses to fill-in-the-blank hashtags. Host Jimmy Fallon will introduce a hashtag topic on the previous night's broadcast and tweet it out. For example, #SlapYourself. Show producers will then monitor the resulting tweet stream and pull a short list of their favorites. Jimmy will select 8 to 10 tweets to be read on his next show. The result is pure hilarity. 106 and Park, which airs weeknights live on BET, is reminiscent of a modern-day version of MTV's Total Request Live, yet it is designed entirely around Twitter. As the network's most popular music series, various hip-hop and R&B music videos are requested via Twitter, and live artist interviews are featured. When on-air talent is introduced, their lower third on-screen display simply has their name and Twitter handle. Everything about 106 and Park epitomizes audience interactivity, not only with its live studio audience, but also the show's virtual viewers via Twitter. Each day, the show introduces a new hashtag and features resulting tweets on a large interactive in-studio Twitter board. For example, #NeverInAMillionYears produced thousands of tweets from loyal fans. 106 and Park's hashtags often end up trending worldwide on Twitter. Television talent discovers live tweeting. The day Oprah Winfrey joined Twitter was the day the microblogging platform suddenly seemed mainstream. On April 17, 2009, Oprah tweeted for the first time. Of course, she did it on her show. It was fitting that she had Twitter co-founder and then CEO, Ev Williams, guiding her along the way. "Hi, Twitters. Thank you for a warm welcome, feeling really 21st century." Despite the spelling error and all caps faux pas, this was yet another milestone for Twitter, which was about to experience its share of more celebrities joining. During the broadcast of his premiere episode on CNN, host Piers Morgan, who admitted to viewers that he had gone from hating to absolutely loving and embracing Twitter, decided to live tweet commentary while the taped show aired. "I'll be live tweeting during my first show tonight at 9 p.m. ET in America and then again at 8 p.m. UK time tomorrow night." Watching the premiere while following Piers' Twitter stream gave viewers a bit of a peek behind the curtain throughout his interview with, ironically, Oprah. And a funny thing happened one Saturday afternoon in 2011, just 2 days before Valentine's Day. During an HBO rebroadcast of the movie Private Parts, notorious radio personality and star of the movie, Howard Stern, unexpectedly took to Twitter and began tweeting from an insider's perspective. "The monologue on the plane about Carol Alt was spontaneous. I just started talking into the camera and there was only one take." At first, a number of Howard Stern's Twitter followers were confused as his tweets appeared almost rapid-fire in their timelines without any context. But once they caught on to the fact that Stern was referencing his movie as a real-time commentary, they were singing his praises and tuning in to watch HBO. Many tweeted back saying they were glued to their seats as a result. Apparently inspired by Howard Stern's Twitter stunt, Survivor host Jeff Probst began live tweeting himself during airings of his CBS reality show. "Don't forget, no DVRing Survivor tonight. Join me live as I tweet while we all watch the show together. It's a global conversation." Twitter analyzed the overall Survivor tweet volume from episode to episode during the fall 2010 season of Survivor, when there was no live tweeting, and compared it with the spring 2011 season when Probst became active on the Twitter Backchannel. The results were astounding. Most of the shows during the fall season produced under 5,000 tweets per episode, whereas in the spring season, the volume per episode was, in most cases, between 5 to 7 times higher. Social media creates the feeling of a more direct and intimate interaction between celebrities and their fans. This leads to a more engaged TV viewing audience who are increasingly abandoning their DVRs to tune in live. The lure of connecting within a community through a shared real-time experience is a compelling force. But does the back channel lead to ratings increases? In the case of Survivor, it did not. The show's spring 2011 season ratings were down across multiple demographic segments in comparison to the fall, and the drop-off was most pronounced with younger viewers. Yet other shows, like MTV's VMAs and Movie Awards, continue to see ratings increases. We take a much deeper dive on the correlation between social media and TV ratings in Chapter 5. Choosing your own backchannel adventure. The backchannel has evolved greatly from its firehose roots. In June of 2011, Twitter rolled out a new version of its search feature, one that, by default, delivers the most algorithmically relevant information in the form of top tweets. As Twitter's Director of Content and Programming, Chloe Sladen, points out, "I am so excited that we're finally in a world where you can watch the Super Bowl and be on Twitter and have an algorithmically refined search without needing to do anything extra. You just click on the hashtag Super Bowl in a tweet, which provides a far more compelling set of search results now. However, that is still only an algorithmic and universal experience. So the question becomes, what can a network do on top of that to shape it? Just because it's getting resonance doesn't mean it's the best complement to the TV broadcast. There's an opportunity for producers to shape and mold the best Twitter plus TV experiences." Networks have taken formal strides with television's backchannel that, while still open and public, offer viewers choices in making their backchannel experience a bit more personalized. After a successful trial run in April of 2011, CBS hosted its second Tweet Week 5 months later, this time in promotion of its new fall television season. Each night, during the weeks of September 12 and September 19, 2011, CBS featured one or two primetime series where fans could chat with talent from the given show who were live tweeting during the broadcast. The 11 selected series included Hawaii Five-O, The Big Bang Theory, and The Good Wife. The network upped the ante again during the week of November 6, 2011. Stars and talent from 23 various CBS television shows and events, including How I Met Your Mother and Mike and Molly, took over their respective shows' Facebook page and Twitter accounts in what CBS called Social Sweep Week. During the 2011 Primetime Emmy Awards on Fox, there was, of course, the official at Primetime Emmys Twitter account as the back channel's MC of sorts. But there was also Glee's Lea Michele at MS Lea Michele and The Good Wife's Josh Charles at Mr. Josh Charles, who live-tweeted the event, sharing their bird's-eye view with everyone following them on Twitter. For those wanting a different back-channel experience, viewers could follow the likes of TV insiders James Panuizic at Panuizic, Jesse Fox at Jesse David Fox, or a number of others giving their flavor of hashtag Emmys commentary. Putting all the back-channel components together. NBC's The Voice premiered on April 26, 2011. The show's synopsis, at its ground level, was a reality-based singing competition. Following a series of on-air auditions, four celebrity musicians, Adam Levine, CeeLo Green, Christina Aguilera, and Blake Shelton, mentored contestants that performed live in front of a studio and TV viewing audience who cast votes for their favorite performances. From a production perspective, The Voice was anything but ordinary. It broke new ground in the convergence of TV and social media. Show producers designed The Voice, adapted from a Dutch TV show, to have social media as its soul. On-air talent accessibility, openness, community, and connection were all tenets of the show's social media strategy. Their goal was to create a real-time co-viewing experience that allowed spectators to become and feel as though they were part of the show. They succeeded by incorporating all of the best that the back channel has to offer television. The Voice hashtag was displayed on the broadcast screen, but unlike the comedy awards, it appeared only intermittently during strategic times when the Twitter back-channel conversation was most likely to amplify. Selectively displaying the hashtag made it behave in almost an alert-like fashion, which helped to mitigate the potential that viewers would tune out. As a result, 70% of the tweets about the show included its respective hashtag. The show's celebrity judges and host Carson Daly live-tweeted consistently during episodes and commercial breaks. The program also established guidelines in advance that prohibited the on-air...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.